let's stand and worship our God together.
My name is Luke and I'm on the pastoral staff here at Sparta Church. It's great to have you here. Good morning to everyone watching at home as well. It's good to have you with us. Just a couple of quick things for the service. Up in the children's wing opposite the Welcome Centre, we do have a nursery for the real young ones, and we have a family room as well if you want to utilise that. So please do that. We'll have our welcome team out there to direct you that way. So will you pray with me? God, we thank you for this service, Lord. We thank you that we can come together and worship you so freely in this nation. God, we pray that as we worship you through song, we worship you through our hearts and our ears as we listen to the word a bit later on. God, we pray that you be glorified, that we can look to you and look to the cross and look at all you've done for us, Lord, so that we can be comfortable and knowing that we are saved and we are one of yours. So God, we pray for this service and we pray so much that you be glorified in your name. Amen.
God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations rage, the kingdoms totter. He utters his voice, the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come, behold the works of the Lord, how he has brought desolations on the earth. He makes war cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress.
Every city. Oh God of revival, pour it out.
About that time when God delivered you over from the consequences of sin and death, and the hope that your life changed, whether it was somebody in your life, maybe a parent or a friend or a family member, whether it's your Sunday school teacher or church one morning, or just reading God's word and you came to the realization that you were in need of God to revive your heart, to save you from the brokenness of yourself and from this world. And he did that through the promise and the hope of our Lord Jesus Christ, God's one and only Son. And we thank the Lord that though he had no sin, yet he became sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God. You think about how powerful that is. And so we pray that God would revive not only our hearts, but those in our community, those who live among us and around the world, that ultimately the Spirit of God would continue to do that work of transforming lives captive in death, and bringing freedom and the hope of forgiveness and eternal life. I'll read for you a powerful verse that I go to often that reminds me again of my identity in Christ. And as we prepare to come to celebrate the Lord's Supper, I pray that this verse means everything personally to you, and if not, that you would receive it and hear it and respond to it before God this morning. Colossians chapter 1, verse 13, "For he rescued us from the dominion of darkness, and he transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins." I love the word rescue there, don't you? That God rescued me. Even though I was sinking and I was drowning in the lostness of this world, God in his mercy and his grace called out my name that one day, and many, many days. And that one day, God was patient waiting for me to respond. And I pray that you can say there was a day when God rescued you from the dominion of darkness. And you probably didn't even know the depth of really what that meant in the heavenlies. The depth of you just needed the forgiveness and the love of Christ, but God did something greater than that. He rescued you from the dominion of darkness, from the chains of the enemy, from the consequences of eternity separate from a loving, holy God, living in wrath and judgment. That is the gospel. That is Jesus Christ, God's Son, that came and gave himself so that we can be forgiven and know the power of the blood of Christ to separate you from sin and to bring you into the glorious hope of God's family. And if you can say, "Yes, I do wholeheartedly, I trust you, Jesus, for my salvation," and by your grace, then let us remember, as Jesus told us, to come before the table and remember the covenant of grace that God's established with us. If you haven't come to that place, then it's more important that you'd just put the elements aside this morning and that you would bow your heart and your head before God this morning and say, "I need you in my life. I'm lost. I'm lost in sin. I know I'm accountable to that. That scares me. You're a holy God. And I ask in Jesus' name, would you forgive me through his blood? Would you come into my life and be my God and be my Savior?" And God is faithful. He hears your prayer. He will hear your prayer. May that be your prayer this morning. If you want to participate as a professing child of Christ, then you can raise your hand. If you didn't get the elements this morning walking in, you can raise your hand. The deacons will make sure you get the elements so you can participate with this covenant promise together as God's people. This is important. You know, this is a privilege. This isn't something we do when we're on vacation as a family or when you're kind of at lunch break somewhere, you do Lord's Supper. No, the Word of God instructs us that when we gather together, and so it's a privilege. Look around. You see God's people, your brothers and sisters in Christ. And so we wait till we come together in order to remember the covenant of God's promise, this eternal covenant. So moms and dads, also before we partake, I just want to ask you to exercise that responsibility before the Lord that your children would profess Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. I thank the Lord Jesus that he tells us that we can have faith like a child. In fact, we must have faith like a child, right? Childlike faith in the atonement of Christ, nothing we can bring or offer to please God, to appease his wrath, but the power of the blood of Christ. And children can understand that. If your children have come to that point and they realize this is not just crackers and juice, but this is a representation of their Savior who gave himself for them too, let them participate. And if they don't know or totally understand before the Lord, explain to them after church today, once again, who Jesus is, what he's done, and what Christ has established in this ordinance as before the church. And so we come before the Lord, and Jesus said, you do it remembering me, until when? Until I come again. Do you know there's going to be a day we don't have to do this? Do you imagine that? There's a day we will not be celebrating the Lord's Supper because we will be in the Lord's Supper. So until he comes, we say, Lord, we profess. And Jesus took the bread from that table at Passover meal before his disciples, and he said, now, this is my new covenant. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this remembering me. Scriptures teach us that same night that our Lord and Savior took the cup and he said, this is the cup of my blood, the cup of the new covenant, which is poured out for you. Do this remembering me. Our precious Heavenly Father, we walk completely in faith, in complete trust, and what you have accomplished according to your plan, a redemptive purpose through your Son, God the Son, incarnate, bearing the sin, as sinless as he was, our sin, so that through his atonement and blood and sacrifice and through his resurrection, our sins have been paid, your wrath has been removed. We no longer belong to the dominion of darkness, but now to the glorious light. And in this broken world, as your children, Lord Jesus, lead us in triumphal procession. May we be the fragrant aroma of the hope of Christ to those around us, that the revival would come. Lord, hear our worship, receive our worship.
We're singing this deep. Your grace is warm, where grace is found, is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me.
Sing that again.
Your grace is more, your grace is found, is where you are. Yeah. our song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand or fall on you, oh Jesus, you're my help and save.
Stained by sin, God, but spotless, covered in the blood of Christ. Lord, we thank you so much that when you look down on us now, you don't see brokenness, you don't see sin, you don't see everything that goes against your own nature, Lord, but you see the righteousness of Christ. And we proclaim and sing together that that is our defense today, and that we will trust in you completely. So find your church, Lord, to be doing just that, as we worship you and now as we look to your word as well. Be honored, be lifted high and exalted in this place, Lord. We pray in your Son's precious name. Amen. You may be seated.
You can tell a lot about how much someone cares about you by the gifts that they give you. True, isn't it? And I've got a little example up here of when my kids were younger. I just pulled them out of my study just to show you a couple of gifts that I got when my kids were younger. This is a wooden cross that one of my boys made out of some wood that was in our backyard. And I keep it in my office as just a reminder of their thoughtfulness there. And then one of my girls gave me a glass jar here. It says, "I love you, Dad," paper mache or something on it. And these things they've got to be close to 20 years old. And I've had them in my study, and I see them, and I watch them. Every once in a while, I get a glance at them. And you know what? They mean so much to me, right? Anybody ever receive a gift from your children, and it's something like that? The interesting thing is, this is my wood that was laying in my yard, and this was probably a Perrier glass of water that we had left over, and the art was made from there. So the interesting thing is that they offered me a gift of something that they didn't even own. You know, it wasn't even like they worked hard for it or got a job, and you know. These are my things that they gave to me. Yet I kept them. I keep them in my study, and I look at them, and you say, well, why would you do that? Because it came from their heart. It was something special because even though they didn't own those materials, they thought of me. And they put something together and they gave it to me. When we think about the idea of giving to God, it has a lot to do with coming to that principle, that reality, that what I give to God is not really mine anyway, that I'm simply a steward of the things that God has entrusted to me. He owns it all anyway, so when I give to him, it's a lot like just a love gift of giving back to what God has already given me. Similar to a Christmas time, the same illustration works, right? When your kids are younger and they comes up to Christmas time and they want to get Christmas presents for mom and dad or for their siblings, and what do? You pull out of your pocket and you give a few dollars to your children when they're small, and you say, go get some Christmas presents for your brother or your sister or for mom and dad, right? And then you open up your presents Christmas Day and you say, this is so sweet and I bought it, but you're giving it to me, right? So, but why would a parent give children money? That's actually a good thought. No, why would a parent give children money to go buy something for themselves? Because you are blessed by the love received back in the effort and the thought of what was purchased, what was done, what was made there. That's the heart of God for you and me. He's the owner of all things. Last week we talked about this in Haggai 2. The silver is mine and the gold is mine. Thus says the Lord of hosts, right? So let me look at Psalm 24, verse 1 is another great reminder. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. God owns it all. Look at Psalm 50, verse 10 and following. For every beast of the forest is mine and the cattle on 1,000 hills. And I know all the birds on the mountains and the wild beasts of the fields, they're all mine. And if I were hungry, I would go not tell you, for the world is mine and all of its fullness. Everything, the Lord is saying, it's all mine. So when you give to God, whether you give of your time, you give of your resources, right? You give of your energy, you give and you offer, you sacrifice, whatever that may look like, however that manifests in your life, right? This week, as God gives you the opportunity, right? As you give to God, you're really not giving back something that belongs to you, like you're trying to impress God with, look what I'm giving you. It all belongs to God anyway. So it's a response of stewardship. It's a principle that understands, Lord, you're the owner of everything. So when I give back to you, I'm giving back to you out of gratitude and thankfulness for that which you have given to me. Who owns a gold necklace here? Who has diamond earrings in your jewelry box? Who owns those, that diamond neck, gold necklace and diamond earrings? Who owns those things, right? Who owns property? Anybody own property? You're afraid to raise your hand. So next time you're a little bit shy on your mortgage, just go to the bank, say, go to the Lord, because it's his property. No, don't do that. Don't do that. Take that out of the tape. Who owns your car? Who does your wife belong to, husbands? Who do your kids belong to? That's all the Lord. It's all rhetorical. So when we give, we're really not giving to the Lord, are we? We're giving back to the Lord. Now, what I want to do this morning is, and by the way, let me briefly walk you through this. On this journey, we're going to be touching on this idea of giving and stewardship. We did last week, we'll continue the next several weeks. We're going to be looking at texts like next week, Exodus 34 and 35. If you want to read that ahead of time, feel free to go ahead and do that. We're going to be talking about how each person gave and contributed to the work of the tabernacle, or the work of building just God's house. And each person had different things that they can contribute to. Then we're going to be talking about this widow that gave of her last two coins. And I think how crazy that thought is. But yet God blessed that. The Lord Jesus said that was actually a good thing. And then we're going to be talking about, can we actually rob God? You ever think of that concept before? That I can rob God. I can take that which belongs to him. And that Malachi chapter 3, we'll be looking at that and so forth. We're going to conclude on our Faith Promise Sunday in December 12th, we're going to conclude with, is it really all worth it? And we're going to look at Mary as she took that alabaster jar and poured that perfume at the feet of Christ. Was it really worth it to give foolishly for Jesus? So you'll be challenged, I'll be challenged, but I pray it'll be a season that goes beyond a building campaign, a season that goes beyond budgets and budget needs and expense needs. I pray, and I really mean this, I pray that this season of learning how to be good stewards will bring such a replacement of obligation with joy, right, that God will transform our hearts in the way that we participate in any way God calls us to give and to serve and to sacrifice. And I'll say this too, and I got a couple funny looks at the first service, but I pray that that phase two building, if that phase two building is built on obligation, that God won't build that building. That if we can get that building put together because God's people are filled with joy to give, then I believe the Lord will be blessed. Do you agree with that? I may lose my job, but I believe that with all my heart. I really do. I really, really do. So let's look at to this morning. What we're going to look at is an acceptable offering, an acceptable gift to God. Right? What makes a gift acceptable? And does God accept all offerings, all gifts? Is he required to do so? So go to Genesis chapter 4. Genesis 1 is a creation account. We come to Genesis 2, and then 3, you have the fall of man in the garden. And Adam and Eve sinned against the instruction of the Lord. They rebelled against God in their hearts, and they fell. Sin entered the world, then they had children, and you come up with these two sons of Adam and Eve, two brothers named Cain and who? Abel. You got it. So I want to look at this because they bring an offering to the Lord, and there's a biblical message and a lesson that we can learn about stewardship here. So verse 1 in chapter 4, and I'll just stop at verse 8 for this morning. Now a man had relations with his wife, the man, that'd be Adam, Eve, and she conceived and gave birth to Cain. And she said, I have begotten a man-child with the help of the Lord. And again, she gave birth to his brother, Abel, and Abel was the keeper of the flocks, but Cain was the tiller of the ground. And so it came about in the course of time that Cain brought an offering to the Lord of the first of the ground, and Abel on the fruit of the ground. And Abel on his part also brought of the firstlings of the flock and their fat portions. And the Lord had regard for Abel and for his offering, but for Cain and his offering, he had no regard. Now, Cain became very angry, and his countenance fell. And then the Lord said to Cain, why are you angry? And why is your countenance fallen? If you do well, will not your countenance be lifted up? And if you do not do well, sin is crouching at your door, and its desire is for you, but you must master it. Now, Cain's response was, Cain went and told Abel, his brother, and it came about when they were in a field that Cain rose up against his brother and he killed him. Well, there's more to the text. And if you're going to cheat and keep reading the Bible during the sermon, I'll give you permission. You can read more about it. There's more about it. Or after church, keep going through the text because there's many lessons to learn from here. But go back to the beginning here of the text, verses 1 and 2. Do a very quick comparison. Some of you know this story. Some of you have learned it before. Some of you are hearing this for the first time. And I pray God's word, regardless, washes over all of our ears and our hearts together, right? Because you can't hear enough of God's truth. As the world throws a lot of messages, it's good to be refreshed and to be taught of this beautiful, beautiful understanding of giving to the Lord. Or anyway, Adam and Eve had these sons, Cain and Abel. They were both given responsibilities. Cain was the tiller of the ground. Abel was the keeper of the flocks. Now, that's not a distinction out of the gate that says, look, one's better than the other. Nope, they're both honorable, respectful positions of responsibility. Just like you have a responsibility in your workplace and your brother or your sister has a different responsibility in his or her workplace, right? Or your neighbor or your friend, or right? You have different responsibilities. And one had this responsibility, and it was a great responsibility, and the other had the other, Cain and Abel. And God gives us each different talents, does he not? Different abilities. We all can't sing the same. We all can't do mathematics the same. We all don't have the ability to, gifted by the same Spirit to do the same thing. We are given different gifts, right? For the sake of the building up of the body and the proclamation of the gospel. So if you even carry that principle all the way to spiritual gifts, like in 1 Corinthians 12 and so forth, you'll see that the equity of God is that not all are the same. We're the same in salvation, but we have different responsibilities and roles. And that's kind of a lesson here in Adam and or Cain and Abel, is it not? Different responsibilities, same God, right? Two different hearts. Now, they were given an offering, verses 3 and 4a in the text. It came about that Cain brought an offering of the Lord from the fruit of the ground. Abel, on his part, also brought of the firstlings of the flock. They both brought an offering to the Lord, right? Now, it was brought to my attention that Cain's offering may not necessarily have been of the first fruits of the ground. We certainly know that Abel's was of the first. We'll come to that in a moment. But it is a biblical principle of bringing the best, the first that God has given you. Why? Because if I can give God the best and the first that God's given me, that means I can trust Him with the rest. You understand that? What a faith step that is. And it comes back to stewardship and ownership. Do I really own it, or does God really own it, and I'm just giving back to Him, and for what reason, what motive, what purpose? Well, kind of the idea of the principle of tithe in the Levitical law kind of came out of this idea as well. It's the Lord saying to the assembly of God's people in the Old Testament, set aside the sum of a tenth of what you have, right? Set it aside and give it to the Lord. May that be a tithe unto the Lord. So you hear that word tithe, right? We say at the end of church, hey, we're going to collect our tithes and offerings. Tithes is an Old Testament principle. Offerings would be maybe considered more the New Testament word, right? But the concept continues in the New Testament. I'll read for you 1 Corinthians 16:2. You may have heard this before. The word of God through the apostle on the first day of every week. What day is that? Sunday. That each one of you should put aside and save that he may give, that he may prosper, so that no collection will be made when I come, the apostle says. So the first day of the week, so you have that practice, right? Within the household of God that we do this collection. And the same idea that we would supply for the needs of the work of the kingdom of God, supply for the work of the local church, supply for the work of the ministry to the community, supply for the work of missions, right? Around the world, that the gospel would go forth. So the idea is not taking the last of what I have, see what's left over, but really the biblical principle that we're learning from Abel is the first. And we'll see why he offers the first in just a moment. But giving of the best, because God owns it all anyway, it's his. It's like, ladies, you ever go shopping for a dress for a friend for like a gift, and you're the same size as she is, and you find there's a dress you fall in love with, it's perfect, it's beautiful, and there's only one? Who's going to get it? You or your friend who you intended to give it to from the first place, go shop, right? So same idea there. Lord, whose is it? Who do I give it to? Do I give it to you first or me? Well, there's a difference between Cain and Abel by the way that the Lord responded to their offering. We see it here. Now again, remember, both men are from the same family. Both men were given great responsibility. Both men gave a gift offering. And it's literally a generic word in the Hebrew there of offering. It's not an atonement offering delineated in the text. Some would interpret that Abel gave of the animal sacrifice, the blood offering, and Cain did not. I don't think it clearly spells out here in the early text that is the reason why that atonement sacrifice system wasn't established. Here, it wasn't the word given of an atonement offering. It was a general offering to the Lord, the word that's used here. So both brought an offering and of the things that they had. So why, the question is this, why would God respond so drastically different with Abel in receiving his but not having regard for Cain's? You want to know the answer to that? You and I want to know the answer to that because you give to God, however you may give to God, don't just assume that he receives it. He didn't Cain's, it was given to God. But when we assume that he receives it, well, of course he should receive it. Shouldn't God be thankful that I'm giving this to him? Ever been there before? That's when we got the wrong syllable in the message here, right? So, verse 4b, repeated here, Abel brought the firstlings of his flock, their fat portions. Great sacrifice, great trust. The Lord had regard for Abel's, but for Cain, for his offering, he had no regard. I don't believe it was necessarily the elements. We can argue that, but it was how and why it was given and presented. The word regard there in the New American Standard, if you go to the Hebrew text, the word literally means to gaze. The Lord gazed upon Abel's offering favorably. And that would be, I pray, every heart in this room, when we give of our gifts, our tithes and our offerings, or we give by serving at Upward Basketball, or we sacrifice by giving of our time to teach our children, or we serve in a community outreach opportunity, right? Whatever it may be, however we may give, if you see an opportunity with a gal, a divorce gal who's got her kids, and you say, you know what, she has a need in my community. I can love and help that person. Why would you do it? What motive would move you to give? And would you pray that and hope that God would receive it favorably, that God would be honored and that God's name would be glorified by the way that you serve and the way that I serve, the way that I give and the way that I worship in that way? But for Cain, the Lord never gazed upon it. So you can do all those things that I just mentioned. Could you imagine if the Lord never even gazed upon what you gave? Is the Lord required to accept an offering? Does the Lord need our offering? This isn't really good for a capital campaign, is it? Let me give you a verse in Acts chapter 17. The word of God, a God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by hands. He is not served by human hands as if he needed anything because he himself gives all men life and breath and everything else. So why this question of giving an offering to the Lord, right? As the scriptures teach us, we should. Well, let me bring you to the New Testament, and you can turn there or look there. Hebrews chapter 11 gives us kind of a Cliff Notes answer to that which we know in the Old Testament, but it affirms it up and it summarizes the heart of Abel and delineates that from the heart of Cain. It comes down to a hard issue, does it not? So look at this. By faith, Abel offered God a better sacrifice than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as a righteous man when God spoke well of his offerings. Verse 6, and without faith, it is impossible to please God. Say that with me, nice and strong. And without faith, it is impossible to please God. Why? Because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. So the scriptures are teaching us, God is teaching us that Abel's offering was an offering of faith that got in trusting God and that God was the owner of all things. And so he gave out of thanksgiving and he gave out of gratitude. Let me give you four simple observations about faith giving, okay, for a moment. If you want to jot them down, feel free to do it. Here's my summary on what a faith gift, when I give in faith to the Lord, looks like. Number one, it acknowledges the complex awe of God. It acknowledges the complexity and completeness of the awe of God. Let's put it that way. Just recognizing his authority and his sovereignty. Number two, it admits an utter dependence for God. Does it not? I'm giving out of gratitude back of the best that God's given me because I'm trusting in him wholly to supply for my needs. And he promises he does. Number three, it accepts the deepest humility before God. And number four, giving in faith affords ultimate gratitude for God's steadfast care. It really does. It's a heart of gratitude. That's why Abel could give of the firstborn animal, signifying that he recognized God as the author and owner of life. Now Cain, let's just turn to Cain for a moment and think about what we learn about Cain from the New Testament, from the scriptures, but also from his reaction when God had no regard for his offering. Cain's offering was offered out of, and by what motive? Fill in the blank. Now, we would have, let me list several ill motives that would cause us to want to give, right? To give an offering to the Lord, church Sunday morning or giving an act of service, right? A love service. So what would motivate me to give? Number one, guilt. Anyone been a part of that? I'm guilted into doing this. I have to do it. If I'm a good Christian, I better. Now I'm doing it out of guilt. Does the Lord receive that offering? It's an interesting question, isn't it? Number two, an ill motive would be to give out of manipulation, to try to bribe God. Go to Amos chapter 5 and see how well that worked out for the people of Israel. And God responds and he says, I reject your festivities, your feasts, your sacrifices. Away with the noise of your cymbals. I don't receive your worship. Why? Because they were trying to bribe God on Sunday so God would do what they wanted on Monday. So that would be a wrong motive to give back to the Lord. How about just the heart and the seat of pride? The ability to give because I have the ability to give. It's like the Pharisees who stood in the temple courts and made a loud clang when they threw their gifts down the altars, right? When they gave, that's look what I can give. God, look how much I gave you. Look how much I served you. Would God receive that offering? And then I would say, Cain probably mixes between three and four, but I would say four, another reason that most of us probably fall prey to, is giving out of obligation. Giving out of obligation. Now, there is a need, right? So pastor stands up, says, we're behind this much money this year in our expenses to giving. We present that, right? So all of a sudden, you and I as God's people who go to church here, we worship here, our children are discipled here, and this is my church family, and I feel obligated. I got to be a part of that. If my motivation is to give out of obligation, right, now I'm giving out of potential resentment, bitterness, maybe entitlement. I'll do it, but this is, right? So let me give an example of giving out of obligation, right? Husbands, you come home on your anniversary day from work, and you've got a dozen roses and a box of chocolates, and you ring the doorbell, and your wife throws the door open, and she's all dolled up, and she's beautiful, and her hair is all done, and she smells beautiful, right? And she goes, hello, something like that, whatever, right? And you stand there, and you smile, and you go, here's roses and chocolates because it's my duty. If we give to the Lord out of obligation, would the Lord receive that? Would he bless that? Now, the gold and silver is his. We get it. The Lord can do what he wants to do. But I think it's a lesson that potentially sin is crouching at your door because you got a heart issue, Cain. And your murder of your brother came out of a heart of jealousy, which stemmed from a pride. Pride in his heart. And ultimately came down to his pride because he misunderstood the whole concept of stewardship, of what it really meant to give out of faith and trust and gratitude to God. 1 John chapter 3, verse 12 gives us the instruction, the application. Do not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one and murdered his brother. Why did he murder him? Because his own actions were evil and his brother's were righteous. I would use the word pure. His brother's heart was pure there. Cain's was not. It was a heart issue. And so Cain responded, and the Lord gave him a warning. God was not rejecting Cain. Aren't you glad for that? He didn't say, I reject you, Cain. No, he says, he gives him a warning. You must master it, Cain. You got to master your heart. You got to trust me. Turn to me. And it's the condition of the heart that steers the motivation of the will, which affects how we give. I am so glad that our Lord Jesus didn't give us the leftovers. I'm so glad that our Lord and Savior didn't give his life and my place and your place because he was obligated. It was his duty. But it was actually because he loves you that much. And Abel loved God that much, that with what portion he had, he gave that to the Lord first. And the Lord saw his heart. Now, it's a New Testament principle on giving as well. 1 Corinthians 9:7, I'll give you this verse, just a couple verses and we'll close. Each man should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. You've heard that before, right? Say cheerful giver with me. Cheerful giver. Say it now, smile when you say. No, okay. It's the story of a mom who brought her little girl to Sunday school. Says, I'm going to give you a dollar and a quarter, and you're going to give to God one of those two. She came back after Sunday school, and she had her dollar still, and the quarter was gone. She says, why did you choose the quarter, not give God the dollar? And she said, well, the Sunday school teacher read that verse, that God loves a cheerful giver, so I thought I'd be much happier giving the quarter. Folks, there's joy that comes in giving when you understand the principle of God's ownership and man's stewardship. My stewardship of what I got. There's a joy that comes in that. There's a freedom that comes in that principle. And it's not to the glory of man. It's not for my benefits, but it's God's glory and my joy, because he promises my joy and my satisfaction, and he is our provider, our Jehovah Jireh, right? God, not our Jehovah Jireh. Some of you are in a difficult spot right now. You're in transition with your houses. You're in transition with jobs, maybe employment. Maybe you're in a spot right now where you're kind of like, this is a tricky spot to be in. Can I give with joy out of gratitude for what God has given to me? Marianne O'Rourke, who recently passed away, shares this little story in her own world. She says, as a little girl, I heard grown-ups repeat a Bible verse that I was certain said, God loveth a cheerful liver. She said, I asked my grandma what a liver was. It's a part inside you, she said. She said, it's like your stomach or your heart. And I puzzled over how my insides could give more cheerfully. And one day in Sunday school, some of the older children who were sitting around me straightened me out, and they said, no, silly, it's not liver, it's giver. And she concludes in her heart as an adult, she says, you know what, way back then, I don't think I got it all that wrong after all, because I do believe God loves a cheerful liver. In the case of Abel, the Lord delighted in his offering and received it. And Abel benefited in that relationship with God. And I pray through Christ that you and I would be reminded, if necessary, or enter a new season of your life to say, this is a good thing to give of that which God has given me, to glorify God, to thank him for his provision. I pray we come back to the heart of worship. It's all about the heart. And that we don't build and we don't evangelize and we don't contribute because we're all that, but that God is all that. And our hearts desire to love him back, truly. Think about it. Why would I treasure this for so many years? Heavenly Father, Lord, I pray that as we give of our time and we sacrifice of our agendas and our schedules in order to serve you and your churches, when we give of our offering, I pray that we would do so you would see that, Lord, we give and our desire is that you would be and you alone be worshiped and glorified. That you would take delight in the offering that you've given us to give back to you. And Lord, then should we expect you to do anything? That is when we expect you. to move and work among your people. And you have, and church family, I believe the Lord will continue to. But take our broken hearts and our wayward thoughts at times and our fears and our anxieties and our selfishness away, Lord, that we would just remember your faithfulness and how you call us to love you back, even through our gifts. Lord, we're going to bring our hearts back to you as we worship.
When the music fades and all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you are looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship when it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you.
Through the youth about this idea of worship being more than what we're doing here. This is part of it for sure. But it's about how we act, how we live our lives according to God, and how we give. So this is a great leeway into seeing what we can do this week as we see what the church is doing for the community and for our world. So out in the foyer, you would have seen the Reach campaign table out there. Please go and check it out. Say hi to the guys out there. And just pray it and see what you can do and what you can give toward that, because God's going to do some amazing things through Phase 2. We really believe that. Right here, we have the Operation Christmas Child shoe boxes. You would have seen them coming in. If you missed them, they're on your right-hand side just before you hit the exit doors. These need to be back by next week, okay? So if we have these at home or you want to get one now, make sure you bring it back next week. That'd be awesome. Another way that we can support those who are less fortunate in our world is through the Sedan Project. So once again, we're giving towards that, and we'll be collecting the offering on Christmas Eve on both of our services. So what a great way that we can bless and honour other people. We also have an upwards basketball program happening again. We need volunteers. So a way that we can give, this idea of giving our time and giving our skill set that God has blessed us with, we can do that as well. So please sign up out there. We also have our Family Promise table as well. Family Promise is an organization that wants to uphold and uplift families in our county in a way that they provide housing, but so much more. But on the Wednesday before Thanksgiving, they're having a Thanksgiving dinner. So if you want to help out with that and just bless some families in our area, our neighbors, that'd be great. So please go and check out the table out there. I'll actually be standing out there. So come and say good day. That'd be cool. And lastly, we have our offering boxes up the back, just the black boxes up there. And we also have our prayer team up the front if you do need prayer for absolutely anything. Did I cover it all?
You got it all.
Thanks, Doug.
Thanks, Luke. Hey, anybody hungry? You should be, because it's an hour late. We're like past lunchtime. All right. Let's declare this promise, church. It's so good to be together. I love it. Look forward to it. And it's just fun to be together. May the Lord bless you this week. May He give you health and the ability just to lift up Christ's name, those around you. Let's declare this promise together. Now, may the God of peace Himself sanctify you completely. And may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful, and He will surely do it. And all of God's people say, Amen.
So with the sinner's restless heart.